This is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com here in my front yard garden, and I have a very special guest with me today. So this is the man, and he's eating my homegrown strawberries.
I thought you meant the strawberry. Okay.
That's my special guest, and it's going to get eaten.
My special guest.
Well, anyways, I have a good friend here with me. His name is Don Weaver, and he literally wrote the book, and he's a modest guy, but he wrote the book on soil remineralization and using rock dust. And he got me into the rock dust, and that's why I'm so excited about rock dust. So I'm here now with the expert, and I call him an expert. He probably wouldn't consider himself an expert, but I think he's the expert. He knows a lot more about rock dust than most people, in my opinion.
Tell him who the real expert is, John.
Nature is the real expert. We want to just model nature, you know? And people try to make nature hard by spraying toxic chemicals. You know, chemicals don't appear in nature. Miracle-Gro don't appear in nature. But guess what? Compost appears in nature. Things like rock dust and minerals that should appear in nature but are getting harder to find in nature. So we need to maybe duplicate nature and use technology to emulate nature. That sound right?
Sounds like a plan. Yep, I think that's very accurate. My perspective is nature's got a pretty good design going, and if we're wise, we'll study it and see how Mother Nature does things on the planet, and then when it's productive and constructive and health-promoting, we should obviously imitate or cooperate with those methods and those systems. So as far as the soil life system, which produces all the vegetation and all the plant and animal life on the earth, it's all based on the foundation of a healthy mineral base and a complete mineral base. The minerals are the first food of the microbes in the soil, and the microbes are the first step in the whole chain of life on Earth. So if we, our first responsibility in being good stewards or caretakers or regenerators of the Earth would be to make sure the soil microbes have their complete natural diet, which is basically the rock minerals from the Earth's crust plus the organic matter that grows out of the Earth that needs to go back to the soil to replenish and build it up. Year to year, potentially we can build the soil to a higher level of fertility each year if we're giving more than we're taking from the soil. So I and others have been experimenting with rock powders for the last, say, 30 years. And before that, people were doing it back in the 1800s, and some people even further back as far as the Essene cultures in the Middle East. Supposedly they use ground up rocks to add to their compost to make a much more fertile compost and produce the basis of their fertility and health back many centuries ago. As Edmond Bordeaux-Zaquet talks about in his book, The Ecological Health Garden, very interesting book.
What's the difference between like the azomite that I have here, the Gaia Green glacial rock dust, and here's the ocean solution or ocean grown solution, basically minerals from the sea concentrated in a bottle. Much easier to ship. And then we have just an example here of some other kind of stuff that's sold as a rock dust, but kind of looks like sand to me. So what's all the differences? And, why don't you just start with that?
Okay, sure. Well, azomite's been around probably 50 years now. It comes out of Utah. The name comes from A to Z of minerals. A-Z-O-M is A to Z of minerals. Ite, to make it a cute name. And so it has... It has every element in the Earth's crust, as far as we know. It's been analyzed extensively, so it is a pretty complete mineral fertilizer. Legally, some of these things aren't fertilizers, according to some state laws, but in terms of the definition of creating more fertile soil, these are fertile soils. A lot of the chemical stuff out there that are called fertilizers, I think, might more accurately be called defertilizers, because in the long run, they result in depleting the soil of fertility, because they're adding maybe three elements or so back to the soil to stimulate the crops to take out 60 to 90 minerals. So does that make sense in the long run? Obviously not. I don't think it makes sense in the short run either, but that's been the habit of humanity since World War II, approximately, the chemical forcing of soil production by adding stimulating chemicals akin to adding stimulants and drugs to the human body to try to force out some expression of health instead of building it from the sane foundation upwards. Anyway, azomite is a good product that's on the market. I don't particularly advocate any one product, or I think any of them that work well in one's local environment and is practical to bring in makes sense to consider as a source. The Gaia Green Glacial Minerals, is that this one? I've been using this one about the last 3 years and getting really good results with it. Comes out of British Columbia. It's a natural glacial mix of rocks, and usually the best rock dusts are from mixtures of rocks, which are mixed up by the glaciers. Hello, white cabbage butterfly. They're apparently interested in this topic as well, as they should be.
They like mineral-rich food, too.
They like mineralized brassicas, the best. And they don't need to munch up all your plants. They can get a few bites, and they're done. And you got all plenty for yourself. Important principle. Anyway, Gaia Green Glacial Rock Dust, Gaia being a name for the Mother Earth, is a very good source. Comes out of British Columbia. A lot of places are marketing this now. Peaceful Valley Farm Supply and Harmony Farm Supply out in this area, in Sebastopol area. And quite a few others. Lingso Garden Materials in Redwood City, down near where I live in the San Francisco Peninsula. So that's a good one.
So does that have all the same, I can't say all the same because it's going to have a different spectrum of minerals, but...
Different balance, but basically the same full spectrum is usually what's found in glacial mixes, because the glaciers crush and grind rocks from a number of different strata of the Earth's crust and mix them together and spread them out over usually huge areas during the glacial periods, and on a smaller scale in the interglacial periods, they... Like in the Hunza land, where the people are reputed to be the healthiest people in the world and among the longest lived, as you can read about, say, in John Robbins' Healthy at 100 book, the Hunza people are benefiting every year from the glacial meltwater coming down out of the Himalayas above them, and the glacial meltwater is full of the finely entrained rock powder ground by the glaciers. They call it glacial milk in Hunza land, and they drink it as well as add it to their soil and all their crops, so they have super high quality food there. Remember Dorleen Tong from the San Francisco Raw Food Group went there and tasted their produce. She was amazed, you know, she hadn't really tasted true organic mineralized produce. Big upgrade from standard organic produce grown often with slaughterhouse byproducts and animal manures and benign neglect to adding all the minerals and making the soil just so much better. A lot of the taste compounds, as well as the health-producing compounds, are found in the trace minerals. So if you're lacking molybdenum and zinc and manganese and various trace minerals, the quality of the food and the taste value of the food goes way down. And there's been studies showing, like since early 1900s, there's been 20 to 80% drops typically in most minerals measured from the foods back then compared to now. So we're seeing a cumulative demineralization of the soil year after year, decade after decade, leading us to, if not total extinction, which is possible, to a state of degeneration where we're not even conscious and able to understand what's happening to us, like the frog in the frying pan where they gradually turn up the water and it doesn't jump out, it just stays there and gets boiled. You know, the degeneration of the human brain and body and spirit, along with ecological degeneration, seems to go hand in hand. So we're obviously part of this whole system. If we want to upgrade our health, it's not just human health we need to be concerned, it's total ecological health that's obviously the issue. Should be obvious. I hope it's becoming more obvious to all of us. Anyway, remineralization of the soil is such a simple way to give back to nature, like potentially hundreds of years of depletion in almost overnight. We can be generous, give back to the soil what we've been taking for decades or even centuries, and repay this debt to nature that's been accumulating. And I suggest we repay as soon as possible. John mentioned this ocean solution. There's a few products using sea solids or sea solutions, which I think have a good place in advanced mineralized organic agriculture. I haven't tried them extensively myself, but I've read enough testimonials and results that people are getting to know that it's a very helpful product if it makes sense for you to bring this into your local garden or farm. John mentioned maybe cheaper to ship this. Well, it depends partly on like the quantity. I think ideally we should be shipping billions of tons of gravel dust all over in trains and trucks. You know, get it out there in generous quantities. So whether a truckload of this would be cheaper than a truckload of actually probably roughly the same weight, volume, whatever. It's probably comparable, but whatever we need, I think everything that is helpful, we need to get out as soon as possible to repay this debt before nature stops renewing our lease on life and kicks us off the planet. Nature is the landlord, and we haven't been very good tenants, as you probably all know out there. So then this last one John is showing me for the first time, it's a new product on the market that we're not sure will be really as helpful as these others, because it doesn't seem to be very full of fine powder, and usually you need something pretty fine to feed those tiny mouths of the tiny microorganisms. They can't eat big rocks, obviously, and even sand-sized particles tend to be big rocks to these tiny microbes. So it makes more sense to grind it fine, and we're a little doubtful this is fine enough. It's mostly sand-sized, it appears, but it really needs to go through what's called a sieve analysis, going through different size sieves or screens to show how much will pass, say, through a 50 hole per square inch screen, and a 100 mesh screen, and a 200 mesh screen. Usually you want something at least going through 100 mesh, and better a 200 mesh, even a 400 mesh screen, which makes like a really fine, like a talcum powder or a rouge kind of fineness to it. So that'll feed the organisms really fast and generously. So we'll have to do some growth tests with this, as will the manufacturers if they haven't already, and see if it'll be a good one to use for some people.
Another question my viewers have is that, you know, I use these guys because they're luckily are available here, but most people don't have a good, you know, farm supply store in their local area, and most places actually don't carry this, and it's very hard to find, unfortunately. And I wish every farm supply, I wish Home Depot sold this stuff. They should. I'd be making sure it'd fly off the shelves, and people would get results, and they'd buy it more. So, hey, if you work for Home Depot or Lowe's, you know, you guys should pick up this stuff.
And I've written to the CEO of Home Depot. Did you get my letter and the articles that I sent you? Please reconsider. I've heard nothing back.
Evidently not yet.
Not yet.
Maybe they'll watch my video. But anyways, so if people
watch
can't...
all his videos. They're worth your time.
If people can't get these products, you know, I know another source of gravel dust is really the, you know, gravel yard or, like, you know, places that sell gravel and rocks. So tell us about that and how people would get that stuff and get by the truckload, and if it'd be as good as this, or if it's better, obviously, than nothing, right, Don? Why don't you tell us about that?
Sure. Well, as Forrest Gump might say, sometimes you get some really good, fine gravel dust at these gravel pits. Sometimes they'll be crushing and screening gravel to different sizes, and most of their market is for the larger gravels and cobblestones, maybe, or sand. You know, sand is a big market for sand. And sometimes they don't really have a market for the very fine dust, which might end up in a big pile off to the side that just sits there often. And you can buy that. Sometimes they'll give it to you for free, or you could certainly ask, you know, do you think I could have a sample of your fines? They often call them fines or rock dust or gravel crusher screenings. But you could ask what's the closest thing to a rock dust or powder that they have, and ask them if you might do some experiments to see how it works in your horticulture, agriculture, or forestry experiments, you know, growing trees or gardens, whatever. And often they'll give it to you, or maybe they'll say, well, we have to sell it for $10 a ton or something. And that's a bargain, $10 a ton. If you can get something that shows promise, you might want to take a little bit first, do some pot tests with and without it, a few pots, different fast-growing vegetables like radishes grow fast, or any fast-growing plants you can think of. So that's a good way to go about it and see if it works, and then maybe you can establish a relationship where you can just get as much as you want anytime for, you know, a cheap or reasonable price. And then if they have a big amount more than you can use, you can tell your friends about it, or go in with group purchases, or tell your gardener and farmer friends, and may as well take that pile sitting there and get it out in the soil where it'll do some good for all of us. And also, of course, it'll help save the climate, which is deteriorating. We can grow much more biomass to suck in the excess CO2 and bring it down to normal interglacial levels, so we don't totally wreck the climate and throw us into either a total chaos climate or another glacial period, which is very possible. You can read about that in the Survival of Civilization book that I co-authored with John Hammaker, and the later book I wrote called To Love and Regenerate the Earth. They're both free online at soilandhealth.org. That's the Soil and Health Library. I recommend a lot of good information there on human health and planetary health and soil health. So along with John's excellent website, soilandhealth.org is a very good one, and remineralize.org, my friend Joanna Compe started 20 plus years ago, and that's an excellent resource for gravel dust, commercial sources all around the world, and also a lot of good articles and information there you can tap into. So remineralize.org, I highly recommend.
All right, so this is John Kohler
and Don Weaver
with growingyourgreens.com. Keep on growing and use some rock dust. It's good for you, it's good for the soil, it's good for the planet, it's good for everyone. We'll see you next time.
Live long and prosper.